Are you excited?
Yes.
No, you're not saying a yes. Are you excited?
Yes.
Not really. Are you excited?
Yes.
Amen. We have to be excited because this is the time where we are going to listen about the Word of God. We're going to listen about what God has in store for us this morning. And it's very exciting. You know what? You don't have to only wait for the preacher to come and preach. Because the Word of God is spoken to so many servants this morning. God is speaking to various people in this church. And I want to encourage you that don't be afraid. If you have a word from the Lord, come and speak. We give you a time after worship. We give you some 5-10 minutes. You have a time. If the Lord is prompting you to speak, take the mic, speak. You know, don't worry. You just have to speak. You have to open your mouth. Gather some courage. God is speaking to each and every child of His. Hallelujah. Because you all and we all are the anointed sons and daughters of the living God. Hallelujah. So we got to think that, you know, that we have a great thing in store for the Lord and God can do mighty things. Hallelujah. And so we're going to quickly look into some few things what the Lord has got in store for us today. And before we just go ahead, just want to encourage you that continue to pray for your brothers and sisters in the church. Okay, we have to learn to fellowship more often. The more we fellowship, the more we'll burn together. Not burn to damage ourselves, but burn to build ourselves. The fire of the Lord will constantly come upon our lives. We will never feel bored being a Christian. We'll never feel tired being a Christian. No matter if you're 20 years in the Lord or 30 years in the Lord, or from birth you know Jesus and you've been married and now you're having a Christian family, but you should be very careful that your life don't become a monotonous life. Many of our brothers today shared and God spoke to their hearts, saying that it's very important as a Christian that we be real to ourselves, we be true to ourselves. And that is what God wants us to focus on. And one of the major principles that today God wants to speak to you is, what I'm going to talk to you about is to abide in the Lord, to abide in Him. We don't often use this word abide, do we? I mean, I have never told my wife, Suchi, abide in me. I've never said that. I never used that terminology. Oh, have you used, has any wife used this term to their husband? Oh, husband, abide in me. Brother, abide in me. Sister, abide in me. And neither when we go out in the church, we say, instead of saying, we don't say abide in you, Lord. Abide in us, Lord. You know, we don't use this word very often. Why? Because this word is a very specific word and it got a very specific relevance. And that's what I want to show you today. I want to tell you that this word is so important that Jesus made sure that He mentioned this word abide. And very few places, in fact in the Old Testament and the New Testament, the Hebrew and the Greek, there are various places where the word abide comes. By the way, before we get into that, I want to just give you a very basic understanding. What is the meaning or definition of the word abide? A-B-I-D-E. Abide. Abide means basically to remain. Wherever you are, remain there. Be there. A lot of definitions for the word abide. In fact, in every Christian life, you know, we cannot separate ourselves from Christ. In every situation of our life, we cannot separate ourselves from Christ. Even if you are going for a holiday vacation, even if you're taking your child to your school, to the school, even if you're going to a workplace, even if you're having a party with your friends, you cannot separate Christ from you. Because Christ cannot be separated from our life. You know what I'm saying? You cannot separate him. In fact, every circumstances in your life, you cannot separate Christ. If you're having an argument with your husband or with your wife, you're having some tension at home, tension at work, you can't separate Christ from that discussion. So whatever discussions you all are having or whatever decisions you're making in your life for your future, for your career, you cannot put Christ out of that discussion. You got to get him into the discussion, because in the first place he was never out. He's always part of us. You can't separate the Lord from your daily routine of your life, because Christ has to be a part of our life. And that's what the definition of abide means. To remain. In fact, the Hebrew word for abide is called yoshab. It's called yoshab, the Hebrew word. What does it mean, the Hebrew word for yoshab? I'm going to come to the Greek word from the New Testament, and then we're going to understand what abide. I want you to understand first, before we start, what is the meaning of abide, and then we'll get to some verses. So in Hebrew, the Hebrew word for abide is yoshab. In fact, this word is used in Psalm 91. How many of you know by heart? Psalm 91, verse 1. You see, over there, he who dwells in the secret place of the Most High shall abide under the shadow of the Almighty. So when you're reading this verse and when you're memorizing this verse, what is the intensity of your understanding of the word abide? Do you know what you're confessing? Do you know the power of the word abide? Do you know the significance of the word abide? He who dwells in the shelter of the Most High shall abide in the shadow. Everybody say abide. Shall abide in the shadow of the Almighty God. Wow, that's awesome stuff. By the way, Moses also used this word abide. Deuteronomy 33:27, Psalm 90, Moses wrote Psalm 90, it was Moses' psalm. He mentioned over there the word abide, dwelleth. Let's go a little bit in the Greek word abide very quickly. The Greek word for abide in the New Testament, see the word is different. Huh? Hebrew is yoshab, and the Greek word is called meno. It's called meno. I'm not sure whether I'm pronouncing it right, but it's called meno. And what does this mean? It means to continually dwell. To continually dwell. It means to endure. Endure. It means to be present. It means to remain. Remain. Stand, tarry. Be where you are. Stand, abide, permanent. Don't mess around. Stand where you are. Don't move around from that place. Don't be absent. Be there. Abide. So, the meaning of the word in the Hebrew is to dwell. The meaning of the word in the Greek is to dwell. So, simply means that when I use the word abide in my relationship with the Lord, it's very significant that I need to practice what I say. It's not enough to say to my wife that, you know, wife, I love you. It's not enough. But if my actions don't show that I love her, there is no use what I say from my words. If I am saying to my boss in office that, listen, boss, I'm going to be on time. I'm never late. And for the whole month, you got to show up on time. Which means you're saying something and you're doing the same things, right? So you are practicing what you're preaching or what you're talking. Somebody said that we are the leg and the hands of Jesus. You see, you don't have to carry a Bible. everywhere, because you yourself are a walking, talking Bible. Your life has to reflect the fragrance of Christ. Hallelujah. And we got to learn to understand the word dwell. What does dwell mean? I want to take you very quick. You see a normal dictionary word, if you pick up the word, it defines abiding. When you say I'm abiding, I am, normally you get these words in legal terms. Abiding, it's a very powerful word. Aradhana will know it. She's a lawyer. The word abiding is a very powerful word, by the way, legally. What does it mean? In our worldly word, it means abiding is to accept or to act in accordance with a rule. Accept or act in accordance with a rule, decision or recommendation. The synonyms include obey, observe, follow, uphold, heed, accept. So when you say, you know what, brother? I am abiding in the Lord. You know what you're saying? You are acting according to the rule book. I'm not going left. I'm not going right. I am abiding in that particular law. The law is abiding. Many times we see, you know, people say that. The law is abiding. You've got to abide by the law. We use this word abide more in legally. But guess what? Our greatest teacher uses the word abide. And what does it mean for us as Christians to abide in the Lord? And I want to take you to John 15:4. Let's see what Jesus says. John 15:4. You know, you write it down, go home, and you can go through it. John 15:4, he says, abide in me and I in you. As the branch cannot bear fruit of itself unless it abides in the vine or in the wheat, so neither can you unless you abide in me. Okay, by the way, V-I-N-E, I generally call it wine, but actually it's wheat. V-I-N-E, wheat, yeah. W-I-N-E is wine. We all know that, W-I-N-E. So, when I'm saying V-I-N-E, it's V-I-N-E. When I say wheat, it's V-I-N-E. So Jesus says, abide in me and I in you, as the branch cannot bear fruit of itself unless it abides in the vine. So neither can you unless you abide in me. Now it's a very powerful principle Jesus is teaching us in John 15:4. In fact, I think that the word abide, John is very fond of this word abide. Because he puts, I think it's mentioned, close to around 51 times John uses the word abide in the Gospels, in the letters and in the Gospel. In 1 John, in 2 John, he gives you the real meaning when you say that you abide in the Lord. What do you think you do? What is it that you should do? So Jesus, very importantly, had to deliver this message. He says, abide in me, friend, unless and until you abide in the Lord. What does it say? What is it? It's I in you or you in me first? You and me first. What Jesus says? Okay, first I will abide in you and then you abide in me, okay? No, what is Jesus saying? First you abide in me and I in you. He knew this principle. He always went on preaching that I abide in the Father. Because I love the Father first. I want my Father. He always thinks of his Father. Another verse I like to take you to. John 8:31. If you abide in my word, then you are truly disciples of mine. Many people say that, no, disciple is a very technical term. We are not disciples. We are just child of God, regular students. We don't want to get into the mode of disciple. No, not discipling. Yeah, we are not disciples. Disciple matlab chela. Chela kaun banega? Yeah, even Joshua agrees. Some noise is good for us. We have to be a noisy church. We have to be too quiet, too calm. And you know, somebody said, it's good to be calm. Be still and know that I am God. Where you use scriptures in the wrong context? No. Sometimes when you are cheered up, say hallelujah. But you know, before you say hallelujah, the word goes in your mind. And then you start thinking, are bahut log hai, chhod de yaar. अंदर ही हालेलुया बोल दे, खुश हो जा. Don't display your happiness to other people. Jesus never had that attitude, you see. He always shared his happiness with other people. Hallelujah. So don't be afraid. Speak up if the Lord is prompting you. We are going to complete 6 years of this church. Amazing. It's, you know, I would say it's an impossible task. God made it possible. It's the Lord's doing. And I'm amazed at what the Lord has done. 6 years, Lord, I said, Lord, 6 years, wow, it's amazing. We're still intact. Why? Because it is the Lord's doing. Hallelujah, it's not man's doing. And you know what? It's very important that we learn to move to the next phase as a church. I told you last time, we got to be a little sensitive to gift operating church now. We got to move to the gift operating church. All of you are blessed with a gift, but you got to operate it. You can't operate it when you're alone. You see, the gifts are only operated for the edification of the church. But even before you go there, you will never understand the gift, or you'll never understand how you need to love God if you do not know how to set your priorities right. So Jesus says here, if you abide in me, if you abide in my word, then you are truly my disciples. So one thing that Jesus says, abide in me, I in you. Then he says, okay, fine. You abide in my word, I'm in you. Okay? Because the Bible says the word became flesh and the word was God. Hallelujah. And just want to take you to how important it is that the Lord stated that I am the wheat and you are the branch. And in fact, he says in one place in John, I am the true wheat. You know why he said that? You know who was the original wheat of God? The Israel. The Israelites were the original wheat of, that was the original plan of God. That through the people of Israel, everyone is going to be blessed. That was the original plan of God. Massive plan. And who was the, and who was the wheat dresser? God alone. Father was the wheat dresser. And Israel was the wheat. But Israel did not obey the Lord. They disobeyed God. God gave up on Israel and said, oh my goodness, you. In fact, in the book of Isaiah, if you read, there's one beautiful passage how God says, you know, I gave you a lot of chances. Now you're done and out. Done and dusted. I'm giving somebody else a chance. And that's when God sent his son, Jesus, to be the true wheat. What Israel could not do, Jesus did. He became the true sacrifice of God. Israel was supposed to be the sacrifice. They were supposed to be the example for all other countries in the world. But they failed. Time and again, disobedience. And what not God did for them? How many prophets God sent for them? How many things God showed them in a vision, in revelation, in supernatural miracles, natural miracles? So many things God did. Pick the weakest man, pick everybody who's weak. God made them strong and, you know, won impossible battles for the nation of Israel. But then, you know what? They remained disobedient still. God sent his son Jesus for you and for me. So now what we do? What do we do? You know, what does it say? I want to take you to this verse. We'll read this verse. John 5:38. I mean, the word abide is used in two different ways. Jesus puts it in a very different way. He puts first the positive way of abiding in me and the negative way of not abiding in me. So we got to be a little careful over here. So be alert of and understand the outcome or the implications of not abiding in the Lord. Okay, it says here in John 5:38, and you do not have his word abiding in you, for you do not believe him whom he sent. Well, that's a strong thing. What is Jesus saying? So once you accept the Lord Jesus into your life, it's not the end of life. then the hard work starts. Then you have to learn to start learning the Word of God. You have to learn to start reading the Word of God, meditating the Word of God, studying the Word of God. You know why? Because it's very important. Because Jesus says, one, you abide in me. Then he says, you abide in my word. We already know the definition of abide. So what does it mean? Dwelling in the Word of God. So when you're praying, hold the Bible in your hand. Say verses from the Bible and pray. When you're traveling out, memorize some verses. When you're in office, think about the Lord Jesus. When you're traveling, think about the kingdom of God. How do you think? How can you think about God? By praising His name. By singing some good praise songs. Thank you, Jesus. Hallelujah to you. By praying in tongues. By saying, Lord, I thank you, Lord. I'm so grateful to you, Lord. Wow. By thinking about the Lord every moment of your life is abiding. Is abiding in the Lord. You must understand one thing, friends. You have to give Lord the first place in your life. Husbands, more than your wife, abide in the Lord. Wife, more than your husbands, abide in the Lord. That's first. Parents, more than loving your children, so much first abide. That much intensity of love you show to your children, that much intensity you show in abiding in the Lord. Because Jesus clearly says, see, abide in me, I in you. And then you will bear fruits. We are not coming to fruits now. We are working on abide right now. So, in my understanding right now, you cannot be unfruitful. Because if God did not spare Israel, because Israel was unfruitful, God cut the connection. No, now you are no longer the source anymore. Move aside. If you do not be fruitful, then you are unfruitful. Correct? There can't be two ways about it, right? Either you're fruitful or you're unfruitful. Jesus went to the fig tree. Poor fig tree was good. Yeah, it was all good. But that time Jesus went in that season. No fruits. Maybe sometimes in due season, trees don't bear fruits. But when Jesus comes to you, you've got to bear fruits. Do you know the Lord is coming the second time? How many of you know that? You heard of this? You heard of this?
Yes.
How long have you been hearing of this? 10 years back? 20 years? 40 years? 50 years back? There are people writing books 100 years back. The Lord is coming back. Do you still believe the Lord is coming back? Yes, because the Bible says so. If He's not yet come, He's coming. Of course, He's not yet come because there is a plan of God. So, when Jesus comes, are you going to be fruitful for the Lord? Because if you are not fruitful for the Lord, you are unfruitful. If you are going to be busy in your workplace all the time and making so many excuses of not being fruitful, then when are you going to be fruitful? So what are we praying then? Are we saying when we say, Lord, I'm abiding in you. Watch out. You're saying abiding in you. You know what's the meaning of abiding? It's abiding is to dwell, to remain. Which means in all the situations of your life, Christ is even in you. Remember the verse? Christ in you, the hope of glory. The hope of? If Christ not in you, hopeless. So, think about it. Just we'll take you some more verses. We have 4 minutes more. John 6:56. He who eats my flesh and drinks my blood abide in me and I in him. That is really very hard stuff. What is this? He who eats my flesh and drinks my blood. Now you may say, you know what, I take part in the Lord's Supper, okay? I remember the Lord's death. But is that the scripture what it means? Is that what Jesus meant? No, it doesn't mean. Jesus says that sacrificial life. Remember Romans 12? Offer your bodies as living sacrifice. For this is your good and acceptable. It's pleasing to God. That's a pleasing sacrifice, holy and acceptable to God. Your body is a living sacrifice. Why? Because Christ in you. Look at each other and say, Christ in you. Yeah? A little more confidently. Christ in you. Don't say Christ in you in church. And Christ out of you, out of church. It should never happen that way. You know, you see what? If you're saying that I have a relationship with the Lord, you got to abide in that relationship. You got to live with that person all the day of your life. And you got to make a conscious decision of having Christ in you. Lord, you take your first place. Hallelujah. John 15:16 says, you did not choose me, but I chose you, says the Lord, and appointed to you that you should go and bear fruit. You should go and bear fruit. What fruit are you bearing for the Lord? Maybe you're asking, you know, what fruit should I bear in the Lord? What is the outcome of the fruit? Of course, one of the biggest things the Lord mentions is the fruit of the Holy Spirit. So, if you ask me, how do I know, Lord, that, you know, I'm bearing fruit? You will know it. You will know it. Because people will be blessed by your life. You see, when a tree is bearing fruits, you don't only see like this, oh, what a beautiful fruit. Wow, nice here. Oh, shining here. Yesterday I went to one shop, I bought some eggs. That egg was extremely white here. So I told, kya surf lagate ho kya? No, saaf, sutra egg. Aisa lag raha ki usko todne ka nahi, aise khane ka. He was laughing, ha ha, nahi nahi, hum log acha maal rakhte hain, acha maal rakhte hain. I said, very good, acha maal hai. I'm really telling you, come home, I'll show you that egg. If it's still there. It's white, I do not see such a white egg. Wow. So I'm waiting to break it and eat it. You see, the fruits of your life will always be not only seen, but it will be felt. If Christ is in you and you're abiding in the Lord, the fruits has to come. Okay. In your family life, what is the fruit? Husband, wife. Yeah, you have arguments, but you overcome that with love. You don't have any ego problems, husband, wife, no attitude problem. You don't think one, you know, oh, he should listen to me. Why should I always bow down? Why should I always apologize? That's no fruit, that's unfruitful. Parents, children look at their parents, look up to their parents. What the children see is good things about the parents, no? That is the fruits. Good fruits. And if they see the bad things about the parents, those are bad fruits. Those are not from the Lord, by the way. Why they see bad things from the parents? Because parents do not learn to abide in the Lord. Yashub, Hebrew. Powerful word, remain. Dwell in the Lord. Telling you, if you abide in the Lord, nothing can go wrong. Nothing can go wrong. But you know what Jesus says? That there are some loose branches. Just remember, John 14 or 15 and 15, Jesus speaks in the context where he knows which disciple is going to betray him. So he speaks about unfruitful disciple, Judas, the unfruitful disciple, fruitful, the rest of the 11. He speaks in his context. The passage is spoken in the context. You see, by the way, God knows who's going to be unfruitful. That's another big thing, which you will not get into it. Because I want to challenge you today that God wants you to be fruitful. When you're abiding in the Lord, you see, you have to be fruitful. But the problem is, why we are not fruitful? It's because we fail to abide in the Lord. Hallelujah. We need to abide in the Lord. Failing to abide is more than just a hindrance to fruitfulness. It's hindrance. It's not why that your tree is not bearing fruits? Because there is something that you're doing that is not right. There is something that you're doing that is compromising. There is something you're doing that is unholy. There's something you're doing, because 1 John says, he who says that I abide in the Lord and does not walk in the obedience of God's command does not abide in the Lord at all. John further elaborates that in the letters. So abiding in the Lord, 1 John also says, abiding in love. You got to learn to love. Love those who hate you. Think good about those who hate you, who want to hurt you. Because you abide in the Lord, right? So you got to abide in love. No greater love is this, that a man lay down his life for his friends. Sacrificial love. So that one, abide in the Lord, abide in love, abide in the word. Somewhere else in John, it says, abide in the light. It's all interrelated. Because Jesus is love, Jesus is word, Jesus is light. Hallelujah. So it becomes a very difficult situation sometimes in our lives. When I say that I abide in the Lord, which means that I also say that I abide in the light, because Jesus is light. If I say I abide in the Lord, that means I say I abide in the word, because Jesus is the word. If I say I abide in life, because Jesus is life, I am the bread of life. If I say I abide in Jesus, I got to abide in love. So we got to look at our lives and ask the Lord. John 15:7, wonderful verse here. If you abide in me, listen to this, huh? This will really keep you triggered. Listen to this. If you abide in me and my words, stop. What he says, one verse Jesus says, if you abide in me, I in you. He stops there. But Jesus goes on in this verse, he elaborates it. He says over here, if you abide in me. How does it start? He always starts like that. If you abide in who? Jesus. If you abide in me, Jesus, and my words abide in you. So, whatever you're reading from the word of God, you're walking in obedience to God's commandment. You're doing what the Lord commands you to do. You walk according to His word. So Jesus says, if you abide in me, and then He says the next thing, and my words abide in you, ask whatever you wish. It shall be done for you. How many of you have ever read this verse? Everybody only reads, ask, it shall be given to you, knock, and the door shall open, seek, and he shall find. It becomes like a poem. Oh, how can you forget one beautiful verse? We all say, no? Psalm 37. He will grant, brother, the desires of your heart. Ooh. Ooh. I can ask anything. Of course, people say, they add one more thing, according to the will of God, brother. As if it's so such a sad thing, no? According to the will of God. Because you almost know what God wants you to do, but you don't want to do it in your heart. It's a war. It's a war in the flesh. God is saying something, you are making it all kichadpatti and package and bandage and okay, Lord, I'm here. I'm your Lord. But guess what? Abide in me, my words abide in you, then ask. Then you ask. He doesn't even talk about the will of God. He says, then you ask. It doesn't say, then you ask. Huh? I want to take you to this verse. It says, whatever you wish, You saw genie and the Aladdin. The lamp. Genie, aaja bahar. Demonic, huh? That's not our genie. That's not. Jesus is not a genie or some with a cap. The muscles come up from the lamp. It says over here, whatever you wish, it shall be done for you, no questions asked. Isn't it exciting? Not everybody is excited because you know you're thinking reverse now. Are you mangega? To matlab, I have to abide in the word. If you have to listen to the word, then what you have to do? Manna will drop from heaven or what? What you have to do? Go home after church. Be connected with the Lord. Next day morning, get up at 4 o'clock in the morning, open the Bible, no? Read the Bible. Kaun to read the Bible? I have to read the Bible. What, you will automatically get to know the word or what? No, brother, the Spirit of the Lord is upon me. So when I close my eyes, the verses just pop my head. Imagine that guy doesn't have to read the Bible. Amazing! Wow, Lord, this is great stuff. No, that's not true. That's counterfeiting. Somebody said, I don't know who said it, that don't act as if you're spiritual when you're not. Face it. You're not, no? Just say no. Don't pretend. You got to read the word of God. Got to open the Bible. You got to read the word of God. 10 minutes of you reading the word of God. Just imagine how much you're asking God for 10 minutes. Bargain. Lord, 10 minutes I read no word of God. Now this is my 10 list. Tack, 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 tack. But Jesus says, if you abide in me, my words abide in you. Stop there. It doesn't say my word you will remember. He uses a word. Which word he uses? You're not listening to me. Which word he uses in the scripture? He doesn't say, hear my word. He doesn't say, listen to my word. By the way, he doesn't say, obey my word. He says, if my word abides in you. That's when things happens in your life. That's when a spiritual breakthrough comes in your life. You have to work hard, friends. Because if you abide in me, my words abide in you. It has to dwell in you. What David says, you know, thy word I have hidden in my heart, that I may not sin against thee. That is abide. I think that is abide. The word is abiding in David's life. And so he's saying, Lord, thy word is a lamp to my feet and light for my path. That's abiding in the word. Matlab, you're reading the word of God and you're not forgetting it here. You're applying it in your office, in your workplace, in fellowship with God. By the way, God gives great relevance to the church in the New Testament. I think, you know, the biggest fruit is to have a powerful, productive prayer life. That's the biggest fruit. Anytime you want to know whether you're fruitful, check your prayer life. You'll come to know how much fruitful you are. If you don't know how to pray, if you're getting bored to pray, you don't know how to spend more time in prayer, there is something wrong. That's not fruitfulness. That's not good fruits. If the Lord is abiding in you, he will teach you how to pray day and night. And you will not get bored. You'll be excited praying. You'll be excited praying. And you know, I tell you what, whenever you feel excited praying every day, good news, that's fruits. Amen. Hallelujah. Whenever you get up in the morning and you don't read the word of God and you're getting restless, oh my goodness, Bible ne padha yaar, kya ho raha hai life mera? That's fruits. What is that? Fruits. Call kiya kisi ne, arre jaldi aa jao, abhi aane ka, par Bible padhne ka pehla. That's fruits. That is fruits. Somebody in your office saying, no, bahut problem ho gaya ghar pe. Immediately your mind is thinking, Spirit, I'll pray for you. That's fruits. That's the fruit. You're sitting in office, you're typing, tick tock, tick tock, tick tock. But while you're typing, you're humming a song. Sing hallelujah. Woo! To the Lord. That's fruits. That is fruits. You're coming home. You say, oh yaar, morning ko maine ek verse by heart kiya. Shaam ko meko bhul gaya. Main Bible khol ke padh. That's fruits. Before you sleep, you're very tired. Had a hard day. Pressured day. You're very tired. Tum wife ko bolega? You're praying, no? Don't pray alone. I'll pray with you. I'm tired, but I'll pray with you. That is fruits. That's fruits. Not giving up on the Lord. That is fruits. Hallelujah. Thinking about the Lord. I mean, that's the best way to describe that you're fruitful. Are yaar, Sunday church aa raha hai. Wow! That's fruits. I can tell you on basis of the Bible, if you're not excited coming to church, there's a problem in you. This is basis on the Bible. Aur yaar, Saturday ko house group meeting hai. Wow! Amazing. Of course, you'll not shout, oh, wow and all that, but at least inside you'll feel, haan yaar, Saturday, main aa raha. That's fruits. Fellowshipping with God's people, that is fruits. I repeat what I'm saying. Fellowshipping with God's people is fruits. Good fruits. Fellowshipping more with other people of the world than God's people, that is unfruitful. Tough things, right? You want to go back to what Jesus says? Now don't skip that chapter. Jare John 15 aya. John 16. Sorry Lord, I missed it. Skip the chapter. No, don't skip it. God is not scaring you. You see, I'll tell you what. God gave up the most valuable prize of his life. His son Jesus. He gave it up for you. You and I should learn to give it up for the Lord. Lord, you know what? You must tell the Father God, Abba, you gave your son Jesus, no? Now see what I'm going to do. Wow. And the moment you say Jesus from your mouth, the Jesus' Father, Abba God, listens to you. I told my son's name, Jesus. Woo! That's why it says, Christ in you, the hope of glory. You know why? Because it's only through Christ that God is merciful in your life. If there was no Christ, you see, God, I don't know what God would have done to us. He sees the blood of Jesus when he sees you. That's why his mercy and grace is upon your life. Otherwise, you're finished long time back. Church, I want to encourage you. Christ in you. Don't get Christ out of your circumstances. Huh? You might lose good friends. So be it. Hallelujah for you, Lord. You gave your only son, no? You take this friend. But Lord, let him know you, Lord. Lord, I'm going to make the biggest step of my life at work. Lord, who cares, Lord? You gave me the job. I'll do it for you. You are the giver. You are the taker. You give it all. You take it all. No problem, Lord. Lost me gaya na? Okay, Lord, no problem. My foolishness, Lord. I'm with you. I can't separate you from my life. Sorry. No, never. That is what abiding is. Let's all stand up in God's presence. Father, in Jesus' name, we thank you and we bless you, Lord. You're such a great and awesome God in our lives, Lord. And today you're taking us back to that wonderful teaching, Lord, that you taught your disciples, and you're teaching us, Lord, today, that we have to abide in you first. Oh, Father, you know our weaknesses, Lord. You know that we are weak in the flesh, Lord. We need your grace. We need your strength, Lord, to make it through, Lord. Lord, we want to be honest with you. We want to be passionate for you, Lord. We want to be people who do not forget our first love, and that is Christ, and in Christ alone. Lord, help us never to separate you from from our thought life, from our act life, from our word life. You are the King of our lives, and you are enthroned high above, Lord. Father, we come to your presence, Lord. Today we ask you, Lord, even as we are going to leave this place in a short while and go back to our homes, our workplace, get busy in our workplace, I pray, Lord, help us not to be that busy that we forget about you, Lord. Lord, your word says, when you abide in me and I in you, you will bear much fruit. Father, we know that when we abide in you and your words abide in us, Lord, we're going to see some fruits in our lives. And we're going to give you glory, Lord. Father, we thank you. We bless you for speaking to our hearts this morning, Lord God. Lord, we give you all the glory, honor, and praise. In Jesus' name, we make this prayer. Amen. Let's give a clap offering unto our Lord. God bless you. And before you leave, please meet each other. You can, while you're walking out, so that the Hindi church can walk in as well. God bless you. Thank you.